Hey guys, so it's been a long while since I talked about this book and kind of reading quotes from this book and discussing it. So the book is, of course, 12 Years a Slave, written hundreds of years ago by Solomon Northup. So this is a kind of a memoir kind of thing. I'm not really sure how accurate is the detail that he puts, but this is kind of like his blog, in a way. It is his memoir of having been sold into slavery, and then having spent 12 years as a slave, and his experience of being a slave, although he was born a free black man in the North. So just like the title of the book, it's pretty self-explanatory, but the details of this book is pretty remarkable. So I'm going to start with the quote from page 55. I'm reading it on the iPad, so I guess the page number is not going to be probably not going to match up with an actual page number of the book, you know, and if I put it vertically, the page number is actually even more different. So don't worry about the page numbers, just I'm just going to quote here. So this is after Solomon Northup gets pretty much sold into slavery. Well, not yet, but he's been captured, and this is what happens. I quote, "And hissing the words through his firm set teeth, that if I ever dared to utter again that I was entitled to my freedom, that I had been kidnapped, or anything whatever of the kind, the castigation I had just received was nothing in comparison with what would follow. He swore that he would either conquer or kill me." So, as a free black man, he's been living his life for 30 years. Solomon Northup gets captured in this way, and he's now told that he's a slave. Solomon, of course, doesn't accept that. You know, I'm a free man, let me go. And his captors are not letting him say that he's a free man. And so he's in a situation where he's just being beaten just for saying that he's a free man. So the person who's captured him is just going to, "You're going to say that you're a slave, or I'm going to keep beating you, and you're going to probably die from it." The next quote, "A human face was fearful to me, especially a white one." I found that to be quite a chilling thing to write, because he's been beaten so much that now, you know, anybody white is a fearful one. Next page. "By this time, I had become stiff and sore. My body was covered with blisters, and it was with great pain and difficulty that I could move." So that's how much he was beaten. "I was heartsick and discouraged. Thoughts of my family, of my wife and children, continually occupied my mind." I highlighted this because I imagine reading this in, what is it, like 1840s? So more than 200, about 200 years ago. I would imagine like people who've never experienced slavery, but slavery is still going on. You know, white people in the North, or maybe even Southern writers, white people would be reading this and just kind of experiencing on words the emotions of, you know, at the time, black people were not considered people. I mean, in some cases, that's still kind of true today, although most would hope not in most parts of the country. But some people still think that way. But anyway, this is a time where it's acceptable to think black people as not as people. And yet, this is a text that's a very amazing text, just kind of telling, like, here's what I felt. You know, I miss my wife and family. I was sick. I felt heartsick. I was discouraged. The emotions of a person writing this is it's a black man who's freed and who went into slavery. And I think that makes such a powerful impact when we think of the context of who is writing and at what time it's being written. Next quote. Let's see. Here we are. So the next quote is, I go to page 59. Again, the page number don't matter, but I just say that. I quote, "At night, Ray, Williams, and the boys slept in the loft of the shed, while I was locked in the cell. Finally, we were each provided with blankets, such as are used upon horses, the only bedding I was allowed to have for 12 years afterwards. Ray and Williams asked me many questions about New York, how colored people were treated there, how they could have homes and families of their own, with none to disturb and oppress them. And Ray, especially, sighed continually for freedom. Such conversations, however, were not in the hearing of Birch or the keeper Radburn. Aspirations such as these would have brought down the lash upon our backs." So, he's now met slaves. Solomon Northup is now meeting with people who've lived as slaves all their lives. And that's why they're so curious. Solomon, you were free before in the North. You're talking about these black people who are not slaves. How are they treated? They have homes, they have families of their own. How is that possible? And they're having to have these conversations, but in secret. Because if they have these conversations in front of their white slave masters, they're going to get beaten up. And that's the kind of situation that explains there, which is amazing. I can hardly fathom these times and what that's like. You know, I think it's amazing that we have a written document that kind of details that in such great detail. Next one is page 61. Don't know if I can... So this is about Emily. And this is a kind of the female... Solomon Northup and his experience meets a lot of people. Anyway, so she called them her darlings, her sweet babes, poor innocent things. They knew not the misery they were destined to endure. So he meets another woman who's going to be sold into slavery along with him. And so this is kind of foreshadowing that, you know, these were her children. And unfortunately, slavery is not going to be kind to her or her children. I'm still talking about Elijah. So Eliza was one of the older female slaves he came to meet, or not slaves, but a person who was sold into slavery like this. He kind of eulogizes this way, her this way. She rests in the grave at last, the only resting place of the poor slave. It's kind of sad. Next one is next chapter. Gooden then turned to me, took hold of my arm, turned me partly around, looked at me sharply with the air of one who considered himself a good judge of property, and as if estimating in his own mind about how much I was worth. So now he's being kind of looked at like he's some sort of property, to how much he's worth, you know, as property. So Solomon Northup is no longer a human being, but just a sale piece, a commodity. I did that one. Sorry. Let's see. So this is an explanation of someone. The other one was Leith. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing her name right. She was an entirely different character. She had long straight hair, and bore more the appearance of an Indian than a Negro woman. She had sharp and spiteful eyes, and continually gave utterance to the language of hatred and revenge. Her husband had been sold. She knew not where she was. An exchange of masters, she was sure, could not be for the worse. She cared not whither they might carry her. Pointing to the stars upon her face, the desperate creature wished that she might see the day when she could wipe them off in some men's blood. So this is an example of kind of a slave, Lead or Lev. Gets super angry because she gets separated from her husband. And this is one of the things that slavery did with people back in those days. It separated families, people who loved each other. Page 80. James H. Birch was a slave trader, buying men, women, and children at low prices and selling them at an advance. He was a speculator in human flesh, a disreputable calling, and so considered at the South. For the present, he disappears from the scenes recorded in this narrative, but he will appear again before his close, not in the character of a man-whipping tyrant, but as an arrested, cringing criminal in a court of law that failed to do him justice. So I just like that. You know, it describes this James H. Birch guy who he knows is the villain that was responsible for Solomon Northup being sold into slavery. And so he's just like, for now, for the 12 years that I'm a slave, he's not going to be mentioned. He's not going to appear. But at the very end, he's going to get his due justice, this James H. Birch guy. And that's where I'll end this video, and I'll continue talking about this book in the following videos. If you guys enjoyed, cheers.